morning and welcome to Holy Trinity for worship on this fourth weekend after Pentecost. We have a red rose in the chancel and it celebrates the birth of a little girl, Josephine Frances, to Michael and Morgan Barella this last Tuesday. And the proud paternal grandparents are Barbara and Vinnie Barella. In our prayers, we also include Lucille Adelman, who is hospitalized. And we ask God's comfort for Mike Farragher and his family following the passing of his mother-in-law, Cheryl, the mother of Mike's wife, Barbara. This Tuesday, we complete our four-week Bible study on Psalm 23. We gather online at 10 a.m. and 7 p.m. on Tuesday. Next weekend is the 4th of July. We maintain our usual worship schedule as we celebrate all of our freedoms, especially our freedom in Christ. Our 10:30 service is now the fullest liturgy of the weekend. Since we don't have in-person worshipers, we didn't need to worry about editing down the liturgy. So we have all hymns and all scripture lessons included in this 10:30 service. And this morning we have a special welcome for our friend in Christ, Gina Snarberg Shields, our mezzo-soprano in the loft. Welcome home to Holy Trinity, Gina. For those who are interested in worshiping in person, we have now resumed in-person worship in a limited fashion, Saturday at 5 and Sunday at 8:45 a.m. You can either go to our website and sign yourself up to make a reservation, or there is a phone number you can call if you do not have online capability. Our worship begins with the prelude, helping us center ourselves in the Lord's presence.
Oh,
be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation.
Amen.
Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Beloved of God, by the outpouring of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have received grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope. For hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We are.
reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
A reading from Jeremiah chapter 28. The prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, "Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted. and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you now are ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ, Jesus our Lord. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So here we are, a week before Independence Day, and we can all agree we love our independence and cherish our freedoms. We've heard of how some can go a bit overboard with that self-determination, though, and claim that they don't have to wear masks no matter what anyone says. More importantly than the fact that the government can tell us what to do, especially when it's for our own safety, these folks are missing the message of love of neighbor that wearing a mask sends. I feel fine, and as far as I know, I'm perfectly healthy, but in case I'm an asymptomatic carrier, I'm going to protect you by wearing a mask, which I will do when I'm 6 feet or less away from you. That independent streak in us Americans may cringe when we hear Paul refer to the baptized, us, as slaves of righteousness in the first lesson that Mike read from Romans. Like some people whom Jesus addressed in the first century, we may want to protest, we've never been slaves to anyone. Paul also says you've been freed from sin and enslaved to God. I want to say, I'm free from sin so I can be devoted to God, not enslaved to God. And I'm always saying we serve joyfully as beloved and accepted children of the Most High, not as begrudging indentured servants. So I thought it might be helpful for us to hear Paul's important, timely message in modern and less theological terms. I don't want us to miss it or give up trying to understand it. So here's the message paraphrased. Paul says, you must not give sin a vote in the way you conduct your lives. Don't even run little errands that are connected with that old way of life. Throw yourselves wholeheartedly and full time. Remember, you've been raised from the dead into God's way of doing things. Sin can't tell you how to live. After all, you're not living under that old tyranny anymore. You're living in the freedom of God. So, since we're out from under the old tyranny, does that mean we can live on any old way we want? Since we're free in the freedom of God, can we do anything that comes to mind? Hardly. You know well enough from your own experience that there are some acts of so-called freedom that destroy freedom. Offer yourselves to sin, for instance, and it's your last free act. But offer yourselves to the ways of God, and that freedom never quits. All your lives, you've let sin tell you what to do. But thank God you've started listening to a new master, one whose commands set you free to live openly in his freedom. I'm using this freedom language because it's easy to picture. You can readily recall, can't you, how at one time, the more you did just what you felt like doing, not caring about others, not caring about God, the worse your life became and the less freedom you had? And how much different is it now as you live in God's freedom, your lives healed and expansive in holiness? As long as you did what you felt like doing, ignoring God, you didn't have to bother with right thinking or right living or right anything for that matter. But do you call that a free life? What did you get out of it? Nothing you're proud of now. Where did it get you? A dead end. Now that you've found you don't have to listen to sin tell you what to do, and have discovered the delight of listening to God telling you, what a surprise. A whole, healed, put together life right now, with more and more of life on the way. Work hard for sin your whole life, and your pension is death. But God's gift is real life, eternal life, delivered by Jesus, our Master. Paul almost speaks of our attraction to sin as an addiction. In order to resist the craving for what we know is death-dealing, not life-giving, we have to remind ourselves that falling into temptation may give a rush of pleasure in the moment, but it has awful side effects and disastrous consequences in the long run. In simple terms, is the buzz off alcohol or the high of drugs worth losing your license, your livelihood, your family, your self-dignity, maybe your life? Is the fleeting thrill of falling to temptation really worth separation from the Savior? Think of how much you've yearned to receive him in this Holy Supper over the last 3 months. And for you at home, think of how we all long for COVID to pass or for treatment and vaccines to progress so we can all be together back in the sanctuary. Paul keeps coming back to the saving power of our baptism into Christ's death. In our gathering hymn, Baptized and Set Free, the choir sang these words: were people created, chosen by God, then were washed ever gently with mercy and love. Sin has power no more. Jesus opened the door to a fountain bringing healing and wholeness and more. The water may have been poured ever gently over our heads in holy baptism, but the cleansing of sin we receive through water and the word is a scouring of sin, and it is a purifying of everything in us that wants to claim ourselves as number one. As Paul says elsewhere in 1 Corinthians, you were bought with a price. Don't become slaves of human masters. They say you get what you pay for, but in this case, we get what Jesus paid for with his life on the cross. And because of that, Paul says in Galatians, I've been crucified with Christ. And it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me. A couple weeks ago we sang, 'Tis not all we owe to Jesus, it is something more than all. And so we give our all to our Lord Jesus, and we choose to serve him above all others, because serve we will. As someone has written, servanthood there will be. There is no escape from this truth of existence. The question is only service to whom or to what? Service to ourselves equals service to sin. Because of holy baptism, we can't use the excuse, the devil made me do it. grace to resist temptation and to do the next right thing. As Luther wrote, unless the Lord were in us, the Lord who is faithful and will not let us be tempted beyond our strength, surely the waves would overwhelm us. But he is faithful to those who stand and call on his name.
Thank you.
into unity with one another and the whole creation. Let us pray for our shared world. God of companionship, encourage our relationships with our siblings in Christ. Bless our conversations, shape our shared future, and give us hearts eager to join in a festal shout of praise. God of abundance, make your creation thrive and grow to provide all that we need. Inspire us to care for our environment and be attuned to where the earth is crying out. Hear us, O God.
Thank you. Amen.
beneath the sea, within each cell, with every breath.
We praise you, O God.
Generations bless your faithfulness through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, into the future.
We bless you, O God.
We give you thanks for your dear Son, at the heart of human life, near to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now.
We thank you, O God.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.